working. I'm saying be built to you today. And be built on nothing less than the blood of Jesus Christ and his righteousness. Complete faith and confidence in what he chooses for your life. As the song say, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but my hope and my lean is in Jesus' name. I dare not put trust in human flesh. We had better trust in Jesus completely. It is on Christ the solid rock we stand, and any other ground is sinking sand, which helps us to understand why the prayers of the righteous do avail much. Sisters and brothers, June 20 states for us to build yourself up on your most holy faith. Pray in the Holy Spirit that we keep ourselves in love with God. We look forward to the mercies of Jesus Christ that lead us to eternal life. And we pray for mercy on those who are wavering and mercy on others, for God to snatch them out of whatever fiery furnace they may be in. Mercy on those who are full of fear and even those who defile their own bodies. But let me say this. When you put your faith and trust in God, it doesn't matter what the situation is. What matters is that you're in the arms of the one that can keep you. Sisters and brothers, enter into the Sabbath rest, a place where we can go and build and be built. God will hide you in his tabernacle while we dwell there with him in the secret place. We don't have to get stuck. Even if the situations don't change, God will change you. Because while you're there, he knows how to comfort you. And he knows how to heal you. And if you put your trust in him and you don't doubt, as the old saints say, surely God is going to bring you out. Our conflicts in life are real. We have to guard our heart with all diligence and pull down every stronghold in the mind that exalts itself above the knowledge of God. While evil is pressing on every hand, sisters and brothers, clothe yourself in goodness and kindness, knowing that it is all working together for your good. Faith without corresponding action does not work. Our faith that corresponds is in Jesus Christ. When we decree the word of truth in faith, we no longer labor over a word about the results. We now should enter into that rest and is reserved. And that rest, while we're there, it is reserved for our obedience and our trust in God. As God speaks, as Sister San say to you, listen and do what he says. We must adapt to God's will and adopt the word as the living truth. The word will never return to God void. God knows and his ears are open and attentive to the righteous, but his mercies are extended to help whomever he will to extend it to. Sisters and brothers, trust in the Lord and do good. Acknowledge him in all. Pray about everything. Be anxious for nothing. Wait on the Lord and be of good cheer. He is going to strengthen your heart. Don't be weary in well-doing, for ye shall reap a harvest of blessing if you faint not. Look unto him for your help. Look to God, not to your friends, not to your sister, not to your brother, but look unto God, who is the author and the finisher. measure of your faith. Call on him. The Bible says, call on him while he is yet so there. Hallelujah. Praise him. Anyway, he got you. He'll never let you go. And he won't let you fall. And I love the word in Jude when it says, now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to make you stand without blemish in the presence of his glory with rejoicing. To the only wise God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, hallelujah, majesty, power, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen and amen. Trusting God in the fullness, living in his presence, dwelling in his secret place. Enter into the rest of the Lord. Makes us phenomenal. Make us great women. Make us breathtaking when we can stand before people and declare the word of God, and your life is a consistent one. You don't have to tell people. The word of God and his likeness and his presence will show up in your life. You don't have to go around saying, I'm saved. I'm saved will come out of you. Hallelujah. So it will be mind-boggling, women, and even Stella in living color, as you submit your life and your love unto God and his commands. You're gonna be all right. I don't care how broken you've been. God is still here. He'll never leave you, neither will he forsake you. When it's all said and done, you're gonna be victorious. Hallelujah. And you're gonna win. It doesn't matter what has happened. Just know, the God that created you is the same God yesterday, today, and forevermore. And he will take you from faith to faith and from glory to glory. From one experience to the next, he'll be right there. He will be right there. And he always upholds the righteous. He always upholds the righteous. He always upholds the righteous. And while you're having your adversities, and while you're having your tribulation, or while whatever is going on in your life, look to the hills for whence cometh your help. Your help comes from God. He got you. Sisters and brothers, he's got you. And he'll give you joy for your mourning. He'll give you peace in your upheaval, and he'll give you rest. Hallelujah. He will give you rest, and it will surpass your understanding. This God that we serve, he really is a mystery, and his godliness is mystery. But I'm just crazy enough to trust him. I'm just crazy enough to trust him, because when it's all said and done, and whatever the devil got coming your way, what else do you have left? Tell me, what else do you have left? So I say to you, lift up your head, O ye gates, and be lifted up. Let the King of glory come in. Let him come in. Let him come in. Let him be your God. Let him be your Savior. Hallelujah. To God be the glory to you, sisters and brothers, for everything that God has done for you in your life. Amen and amen. I love you.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much. What? I told y'all she was going to bring the fire. See, so Sam come and she lay it all down. She gave you your green grass and put it in a nice, you know, situation. And then she come back and she light that fire. Come on, somebody, somewhere. So I don't know what you got out of it, but I heard her say, trust him. And when I heard her say, trust him, I think some of my generation, Miss Pam Sparrow, they trust in the wrong him.
Yes.
The wrong him. Who are you trusting when she say, trust him? She's talking about God. Trust Jesus. Trust him. Don't put your trust in man. Don't put your trust in man. She also said on the Sabbath day, rest, a place where you're to be built. How many of us are resting on the Sabbath day? Are we going in for mandatory overtime? Will you put God first? Will you seek him first? She said, faith without works is dead. Some of y'all think Jesus is coming down here, knock on your front door by UPS or FedEx. He ain't coming that way, y'all. He ain't coming that way. Faith without works is dead. You got to get up off that chair. You're laying down too long. You're sitting too long. Faith, where is your faith? And then the last thing she said, dig deeper. Dig deeper. Dig deeper with what you have left. Sometimes leftovers taste better than the original day you cooked it. Are you willing to dig deeper and use what you got left? Phenomenal. Amazing. We appreciate you. So we're going to give y'all like a 5 to 7 minute break. We're going to get some water. We're going to freshen up our makeup for y'all that's live on the Zoom today. And I'm going to excuse myself and use the restroom. And I encourage you to do the same so you won't get up when the fire is being brought. We're going to go ahead and put y'all, get y'all some music on. Get yourself together. I'm full of Jesus. And you thought I was going to be able to get back in with this chair? And the only voice that he is mine for real.
They
enjoy
the goblins. I'm signed out.
Did you?
It says I am.
Oh,
it
is.
Can
okay. You make that beat?
I don't. I'm trying.
So you come over here messing with the pet?
I don't make it.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed that song. That worship. Did you use the restroom? Did you get some water? For those of you that's just joining, we want to say welcome to the women that's gathering together to glorify God. So the next speaker that we have on her name is Crystal. She was participating in a speaker on last year as well, and she also brought the calm after the storm. So, Miss Crystal, if you can take yourself off mute, we would love to hear from you at this time.
Hello,
Crystal.
Crystal,
are you there?
I am here now.
You are here now. Okay. She said we were going to talk about phenomenal women in Technicolor. And I had to ponder over how to pull that together. And I just began to struggle with how to pull waiting with phenomenal woman in Technicolor. But God then began to take me to a very It's Matthew 27:36-46, and we're going to read that. But this passage is so familiar that it's been lifted around the world time and time again. But let me give you a little background. The central figure is Jesus Christ, the incarnation of God the Son, and the awaited Messiah, the Christ, that was prophesied in the Old Testament. And he's coming to the end of his life. I'm talking about Jesus, the one that came to save mankind, is now found hanging on a cross. Body is bloody and battered. And over the cross, it has the words, Jesus, King of the Jews. He has a crown of thorns crushed into his skull. You know Jesus, Jesus. They said that a man like no other man. And his life is coming to an end. And I just want to read this passage for you. Have to put on my glasses. I'm getting a little old now. And it reads as thus. And it said, and they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them.
It's okay, I can use it.
Sitting down, they lost him there and set over his head his accusation. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right and the other on the left. And they passed by and they reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it up in 3 days, save thyself. He said, if thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. He said, likewise, the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and elders, and he saved others, but himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him, for they said. He said, I am the Son of God. The thief also were crucified with him. I want to just take something out of that text for today. And what I want to use as a topic to talk about and try to tie in waiting and phenomenal woman is, it is what it is, but it's not what it looks like. Now, I know you think that I'm going to enter into some kind of Easter Sunday sermon, but I'm not. This is one of the most happiest times of the year for most Christians, because it's the time that our faith is going to be renewed. Now, I might have echoes of the Easter message splattered throughout here, but I'm not going to talk about Easter message, because even though during this time of the year people seem to get happy and joyful, but for me, for some reason during this time, I'm always in a very pensive mood, because instead of the joy, it always takes me to a place of pain and suffering in this life. I mean, if we would be honest and real with one another, we would have to admit that sometimes life is just depressing, just downright depressing. And sometimes it takes every ounce that you have within yourself to just stay alive another day. Now, I know most of us on here are Christians, and we're saved, we're sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. But sometimes you have to say it, that life makes you want to throw up your hands and want to holler. Now, I don't know your story, and you don't know my story. But one thing I've lived long enough to know, that man born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. I've lived long enough to know that it's going to rain on the just as well as the unjust. I've lived long enough to know that things don't always turn out like we think they're going to turn out. And I lived long enough to know that people are going to mistreat you in this life. But don't be fooled into believing it's everybody else. Just because you think that you're a good person and everybody else have flaws. Just because you've done a few good deeds in life don't make you a good person. Because the word of God said that the heart of man is deceitful and above all things, desperately wicked. And I'm referring to your heart and my heart. Romans 8 says there is no good thing in the inside of me nor you that is of ourselves. But in spite of all that we go through, the twists and turns, the pain and agony, the highs and lows, the good times and the bad times, I know that I know now that all things are working together for our good and for God's glory, because the word told me so. And I know that everything that we go to has to take place, that God has already planned for us before creation. Did you not know that your life is just a process? And it's all going to work out for your good. I want you to keep remembering that it is what it is, but it ain't what it looks like. I want you to realize that there are some facts in life that we can't get away from. Fact is that you had a baby out of wedlock as a teenager. Fact is, you served time in prison. Fact is that you were a drug user. Fact is, you were raped when you were a child. Fact is, you were sexually abused. Fact is, you didn't graduate from high school. Fact is, you didn't know your dad and you got daddy issues today. Fact is, you were born on the wrong side of the track. Fact is, when you grew up, you never had any good wholesome role models in your life. Fact is, somebody told you that if you go to church, everything's going to be all right. Mm-mm. Fact is, you went to church and fact is, church folks hung.
Come on, somebody.
Church folks disappointed you.
Mm-hmm.
Fact is that you as a black woman or man in this society are not valued.
Come on now.
And your life means very little.
Mm.
Fact is, everybody you trusted has hurt you. Fact is, people have disappointed you time and time again. Fact is, you filed for a bankruptcy.
Fact is
that you had an abortion.
But what is the truth?
Fact is that that woman or that man walked out and left.
Come on, somebody, somewhere.
Fact is that you've gone through the divorce.
Mm-hmm.
Fact is that church folks have counted you out.
Church folks.
But the truth is, it ain't what it looks like.
It is what it is, but it ain't what it looks like.
But I know some of you don't believe that.
Hmm.
You feel that your pain, your story has been so bad that you will never recover from your pain and from your past.
Mm-hmm.
In spite of.
But I want you to believe that even though it's a fact,
it ain't the truth.
You got faith. And you can't let the facts weaken your faith.
Don't let your facts
faith
weaken
your
faith.
Faith is not defined by your weak moments or your failures. Because in between your despair and disappointment lies your destiny.
Mm-mm-mm.
You got to remember that Satan is on a mission to take each and every one of us out of here.
Don't let the enemy take
just
you
like
out.
Just like he did some 2,000 years ago. Jesus prayed that our faith wouldn't fail us. And he's still praying for
us. Mm-hmm.
It might rock us and it might throw us off balance, but mm-hmm. when we return from our weakened state, mm-hmm. he said he expects us to strengthen our brothers and sisters. So the fact is, you're going through some troubles and trials and you falling down, but you have to get up.
Because
he knows what you've gone through. He knows what you're going through. The word says that before we were in our mother's womb, God knew us. And it said that the plan that he has
for us, Jeremiah 29:11,
and not to harm us. Plans to give us hope and a future.
Mm-hmm.
Each one of us had a specific purpose in life to fulfill. And we're all on a journey to fulfill that purpose. And it even said that some people are appointed and anointed for a special work. Men like David and Samson and Paul and many more. And even those individuals that were used in the Bible had to go through a process. And in their process was pain and hardship and difficulties. Nobody gets to escape. And I want to talk about just one of those fellows. I want to talk about Samson. I mean, you all heard the story of Samson. And it said that Samson's mother was barren. But it said an angel of the Lord appeared to Samson's mother and said, you're going to bring and conceive a son. He said, now I want you not to drink any strong drink, wine or fermented drink. He said, and not to eat any unclean thing. Because the son that you're going to bring forth has been set aside by me. And he will be a Nazarene. And it said that he will begin to deliver Israel from the hands of the Philistines. And the prophecy came to pass. The woman got pregnant and she bore a son, and his name was Samson. And it said the boy grew and the Lord blessed him. And so when he got up some size, Samson went down to a place called Timnah. And he saw a young, beautiful, fine girl that was a Philistine woman. And he went back to his father and his mother and he said, I've seen a Philistine woman. And I want you to go get her for me. And his father tried to change his mind, but Samson insisted. He said, get her for me. She is the right one. Now remember what I said, that Samson's mother was told before his birth that he would begin to deliver Israel from the hands of a Philistine. And I had to stop and say, now how in the world could he go and want to marry somebody in the enemy's camp? But the answer is, it wasn't what it looked like. The word says that God's thoughts are not your thoughts. He said, neither are your ways his ways. It said his parents did not even know that the thing that was in Samson to go and get this Philistine woman was put there by God. Because it was an occasion for God to confront the Philistines. And true enough, this thing did thrust Samson into his destiny. I want you to go and read the story in Judges 13 all about Samson. But it went on to say that his family went down, they got the woman and, you know, paid the dowry. But when he went there, some little small exchanges took place. And Samson gave a riddle and he told the men that was there, if you can figure out the riddle, I'll do this. And if you don't, you give me this. 3 days they tried to figure it out, but they couldn't figure it out. And then they went to Samson's bride-to-be. They got her to tell what the riddle stood for. Samson really was thrust into his destiny because he got mad. He had an anger problem. He got mad and he did some things to retaliate against the Philistines and he left. He walked out. I think he left his bride at the altar. I think that's what he did because it said he left the woman and he left her father. And so the father, when Samson left, he gave the girl to one of the friends who attended to Samson at the wedding. Samson later goes back and wants his wife and finds out she's married. Now that anger problem really flares up because Samson goes on an all-out kill, much like we do today. You know, you get me, I get you back. You get me back, I get you back. I'm going to get you more. I'm thinking of something to get you back. That's how that works. Samson's anger problem got him into some trouble. Because even though he was called to deliver the Philistines, he was messing around with the Philistine woman and got into some trouble. Ended up killing some people. But it didn't stop there because it said the anger problem kept going on. And the woman problem kept existing. Because he met another woman called Delilah. Now Delilah was the woman that reduced Samson to a helpless, defeated man. It said that the fact was that he was chosen at birth to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. But I told you life is nothing but a process. So in his process, after he meets Delilah, Delilah tricks him into giving up his secret. When she gives up the secret to the Philistines, they capture him. And the secret was in his hair, so they cut off his hair. He lost his strength. They gouged out his eyes. The one that God has chosen. I mean, just because you're chosen, don't think you're going to be exempt from trials and tribulation. Trouble still is going to knock at your door. I don't care who you are. I don't care how anointed you are. Trouble is going to find you because it's a part of the process. And you're not going to get around the process. But the one thing that happened to Samson one day, even after they had gouged out his eyes and threw him into prison, Samson had enough sense to pray. And one day they let him out and they was toying with Samson and just ridiculing him, making fun of what they had done to him. But Samson lifted up his eyes and he prayed to the Lord. He just said, oh Lord, remember me. He said, God, give me strength just one more time. He said, and let me with one blow get revenge on the Philistines for what they did to my eyes. And they said he got between two pillars and his strength returned to him. And he was able to push the pillars down and that came down on the rulers and all of the people that were in that place. And it said about 3,000 people were killed on that day. It said that Samson ended up killing more people on the day that he died than when he was alive. God is still the same God today as he was yesterday. Even though you have to go through trials and tribulations, even though you started off with a promise that God gave you, life is going to take some twists and turns in your life. You're going to get disappointed along the highway. But remember that Samson prayed and he said, God, if you can just do it one more time.
One more time.
And I want you to know that God always hears and answers prayer. I know you think because of what you've been through, you won't make it. You'll never see the thing that God told you come to pass.
See what I'm saying? Because it's just 10:20.
You think you'll never see your child come off drugs. Or you think you'll never own the business. You'll never get out of debt. Your body would never get healed. You'll never get past your past. You'll never get healed emotionally of all the abuse that you've been doing. You'll never find somebody else to love you. But I come to tell you that the devil is a lie. Because it ain't over until God says it's over. For God is not a man that he can lie. He said it shall come to pass. He said above all things he desires that we prosper and that we be in good health. And I'm standing on his word. God says that all things are possible if you only believe. All you have to do is have a mustard seed faith. And mustard seed faith, it can go a long way. When you take some seeds and you begin to plant them, they become trees. Your seeds are your faith. If you change your thinking and believe that the word is true and it can be trusted, and what God has called a person to do is what they are, and that they will do what he called them to do, or either God hasn't called them to do what he called them to do or be what he told them they would be. But if God said it, it's going to come to pass, because when God calls something to be or do what he said, he created it to do, it will do it, because God is a truthful God. You got to believe and stand on the promises. When you go through the fire, you got to believe that you won't get burned. When we go through the deep waters, we got to believe that it won't overtake us. You got to know that all the pain and trials in your life have only been to push you into the presence and purpose of God. For the word said that eyes have not seen, neither have ears heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for man. Now, I know you thinking, but that don't pertain to me. But God is no respect of person. I know you keep talking about your past, and you think that you can't get over your past and your pain. But God takes pain, and he takes situations to get your attention, to realize that he's greater than your pain. He's greater than your problems. He's greater than your situation. Peter said, don't think it's strange when the fiery trials come upon you to test your faith.
Who's recognizing?
He did not say when or if. He said when. So you got to know that they're coming. But you got to be able to take all the attacks of the devil. And you got to turn them around for good. stuff in this life. I'm just coming to tell you, we're going to suffer.
She's saying no to everything.
Anybody been going through any trials in 2020? That was a rough year. I don't know about you, but 2020 was a rough year. And it seemed like 2021 is going to gear up, and it's going to be rough. People still waiting on stimulus checks. Don't know how they're going to pay their bills. Sometimes God will push you into the presence and purpose that he has for you by your trials and pain. You got to know that he's working it all together for your good. You got to know you got to endure the process. Jesus showed us about the process. And we're going to have to follow his process. Jesus' life said that he was betrayed with a kiss by one of his 12 disciples for 30 pieces of silver.
That's right.
So I want you to know that somebody close to you will betray you and sell you out. It's just a part of the process. Stop complaining. It's a part of the process to get you to your purpose and your destiny. It said he was delivered to the high priests, where the chief priests and elders sought false witness against him. He said, but Jesus held his peace. Sometimes people are going to talk about you and lie on you.
Yeah.
But you need to be able to hold your tongue and hold your peace, because it's just a part of the process. He said that Jesus, one of his closest disciples, his inner circle, Peter. He said Peter denied him three times. Three times. His inner circle. His most inner circle. But he said Peter was remorseful. You need to know that sometimes your closest friend will not be able to stand with you in your trials. But you got to be like Jesus. In the end, he restored Peter back to his position. You got some friends that have messed over you. You can't keep holding grudges all your life over something that was done to you. And that person really is sorry about what they done. It's time to let it go. Let your past go so you can get to your purpose. It says that Jesus was delivered to Pontius Pilate, the governor who had the power to determine his fate in life. He said even though Pilate found no fault in Jesus, he had him whipped all night long until he was bloody and battered, almost unrecognizable. And if that wasn't enough, Pilate then turned him over to an angry mob to do whatever they felt was right. Because Pilate wanted to stay in favor with the people more than he wanted to serve justice. It's all a part of the process. So when religious leaders disappoint you, don't be surprised. It's a part of the process. Your faith is being tested. Can you still stand when you're being talked about? Can you stand on your faith when everything is coming at you? When you look at our political leaders today and you know that they're supposed to be protecting your rights, and you see that they're doing everything to overtake your rights or take them away from you, that shouldn't surprise you. It's a part of the process. This is life. Life is not supposed to be all good. The process with pain and trouble is what we need in order to grow. I know you think, I don't need no more pain and I don't need no more of this. I've got the picture. We all fool ourselves into believing we got it, but most of the time we don't. And God has to keep working on us and crushing us until his purpose begins to come out of us. Come and tell somebody today, you gotta stay in the process. Jesus stayed in the process up to the very end. Said when he was turned over to the soldiers to be executed, they stripped him of his clothes and put a crown of thorns and crushed it into his skull, just to mock. Said they marched him up Golgotha's hill with the weight of the cross on his back. They nailed nails in his hand and a stake in his feet and placed him on a cross. They stood up there hurling insults at him, saying, "Save yourself. You're Jesus. You saved everybody else. Can't you save yourself?" But he never said a mumbling word. Even though he was hanging on the cross with nails in his hand and a stake in his feet and a crown of thorns on his head, they still took a spear and stabbed him in his side. They said, "Water and blood poured out." When people see you in pain, you got to tell them, "I'm just going through my process. It's just the process. Because when I come out, I'm going to come out like pure gold."
Come on, somebody.
So next Sunday, when you hear the story of the risen Savior, I don't want you to forget the process is filled with heartache and pain. No matter where you are in life, if you're at the beginning of the process, the middle, or the end, it's not what it looks like, but it is what it is. That's the word that God gave me to give to you, and I hope you got something out of it for today. God bless you. And keep on keeping on and stay in the process.
Yes, somebody. Somebody somewhere better shout. I know y'all got that. Stay in the process. So in life, let me tell you what I heard, Sister Krista. I appreciate you. I thank you. I'm honored. I get to hear you again 2 years in a row. You always come with the calm after the storm. Miss Sparrow, she be bringing that storm. See, Santa give it to you. She lay that piece out like, "Come on in the room, y'all. The party get ready, get started. We going to cleave and we going to abide in Jesus Christ." And you be like, "Hallelujah." This is Sparrow coming in and say, "Let me tell you for real what the Lord going to do. Let me tell you." And you be like, oh, let me get my life right. Santa brought me in here. I got excited. And she done get, now that you know better, because they done told you better, you got to do better. And then Sister Crystal come back and she just put the icing on the cake and say, "Listen, this is why Sister Sparrow said, you got to do right. This is why Sister Sand said, the Lord hold on to you. He'll hold on to you in your good and in your bad. But let me give you the icing on the cake." And she said, "It's a process, baby. And I know that you've been going through a process, but your process ain't got nothing to do with God's process. So even though you set your goals, even though you got your dreams, even though you got all that, let me tell you something, God will flip that thing and rearrange your whole life. And all you need to do is look up." I heard Crystal say, "Look up." You may get the facts from the doctor, but it ain't the truth. You may get the facts from your bank account, but it ain't the truth. You may get the facts about your past, but it is not the truth. It is not the truth. Renewed faith during this time of the year. Y'all thought she was going to talk about Easter and the resurrection. Like, I'm going to go to the bathroom on this. She fooled you, didn't she? Fooled you. She talked about that process that you've been going, same circle, over and over again, same results. It is his unplanned process that you know nothing about. But what are you willing to do? It is what it is. Even though she said, but it's not what it looks like. Don't let the facts weaken your faith. Don't let the facts weaken your faith. You were chosen at birth. It is a process. Now that you know, it's going to get tricky. It's going to get weary. However, keep looking up. Keep looking up. Remember him and let him go know that God will fight your battles for you. Your strength is back. Get your strength back. Your strength is not in man. Your strength is not in woman. Your strength is in God. So if you're looking for somebody else to get strength from, you're wrong. Check yourself. You can't get strength from another human being. Your strength comes from God. Girl, you did that thing. So now we're going to go ahead and give y'all some music real quick. And then we're going to introduce Pastor Cheryl. Now, y'all got the icing on the cake. Now it's time for the cherry on top. But we're going to get you some music first. Don't go nowhere. I'm telling you, don't go nowhere. Sister Cheryl can't sit down. She can't sit still. She'll be all over your Zoom. And you'll be looking for her. And she'll be hearing Jesus be gone. Hearing Jesus be gone. So, don't miss this cherry on top of this cake. We're going to bake this whole cake. You smell the aroma anointing of the cake. You got your living water. We get ready to eat the bread of life. You do not want the abundance, the overflow. And that is the cherry on the cake. So go ahead, listen to your music, get your worship on. Let God enter into your heart and into your mind. And let's get prepared for a piece of cake with the cherry on top. We'll be right back. Hey, y'all. We just having a good time. See, y'all don't miss the conference. Y'all ain't even registered. See, y'all ain't get no email. Y'all didn't get no email. Y'all ain't get no free CD. Look what I got. Because I registered for the event, I got mine in person. You would have got yours in the mail. Royalty. You get a free gift. You ain't had to pay a dime. And she gonna mail you a gift if you would have registered. So how dare you not register this year? Is the link still up on my page? Go to the link on my page. Go ahead and register. She ain't shut the thing down yet. I think she was too busy and she forgot to shut it down. So you have an opportunity to just register. She did.
No, she will.
Oh, yeah. Y'all better register. Don't miss it next time. I think we did it this time. The first time she did it was a year later. This time it's like 6 months. But people want it. You better come get it. Come get the living water. You've been drinking that bad Dasani water or whatever water you've been drinking. You better come get the living water. And the bread of life you've been drinking been putting pounds on you. So, you better get the bread of life. Women gathering together to glorify God. Go ahead and I'm going to put this phone on black. But you're going to hear this worship music, all right? God bless you. We'll be right back.
You
got hot water in here. I can make my own coffee if it's ever already in here.
It was like, I'm fucking going to go out.
Bring stuff in here. Spoons in the other drawer adjacent to it on this side. Oh no, it's halfway. At least we was in town. DC. Nah. It's 7:40 and it's at 4:09.
Yeah, I mean, if we was loud enough, get your life together. It's not about you, Jesus. How you gonna get to the next level if you keep being nervous? Your people is on Zoom. You can tell they got on their pajamas. They still chewing on their breakfast from this morning. The seasoned folks are on Zoom. Some of them heard people calling her, somebody can hear her online. Uh-huh. Your people not online.
Okay, and you click the
joint event? They talking about Zoom. Yeah. Okay. Is this about
the end of the song?
I'm just turning the computer around, so I'm about to be over.
Okay.
Gotta do something. Miss Tom, I'm about to end. I'm gonna bring Cheryl. I gotta bring Miss Cheryl up. Women gathering to glorify God. Women gathering to glorify God.
So once you open up the email, scroll to the bottom, you'll see the email address. Hallelujah. Come on, let's praise the Lord. Come on, let's praise the Lord. We've had a lot of word this morning, so let's stop right now and let's give God praise. Come on, we got a lot of word, a lot of good word. Let's stop and praise the Lord. And I'm going to ask you to do as many as can. I'm going to ask you, I don't know if you did an introduction. Don't need no introduction. But I praise God. Take your mics off just right now. And let's hear some praise right now. Come on. Take your mics off.
Hallelujah. Y'all better say hallelujah. Let's give God some praise. Come on. We can't hear y'all, so make sure y'all put it in y'all's chat. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
His word is alive. we're not talking about a dead father, y'all. He is alive. He's well. He's able. He can. He will. He shall. He's always present tense. He's never past tense. He's always present tense. Whatever we're going through, he's present in that tense that I'm walking through right now. Do you hear what I'm saying? You cannot go by what somebody else said. And I want to tell you, nobody can stop me believing in what God do. If I believe in the impossible, you don't believe that? It doesn't stop God from moving in my life. Because if you're not there yet, that doesn't move in my life. I do not base my belief, and you should not base your belief on the contingent of a man's belief. You base your belief on the contingent of the word of God. And you get in link with God, and you abide in God. And when you abide in God, he said, whatsoever thing you ask. Not whatsoever thing your mama asked, your cousin asked, your sister asked. See, your faith, it depends on where I am with God. Hallelujah. Your faith should ignite me. You should provoke me to do various things for God. But you can't stop me from believing what God can do. Because he said he will do the impossible. He will do the impossible. What looks impossible, y'all got to understand, sisters and the brothers that are on here, that God loves showing up in the impossible situations. When it does not look like it's going to work out, when it looks crazy, when it looks foolish, he loves to show up. And the reason he does is because he said, no man shall touch my glory. When he sees that you're getting too close of touching his glory, he switched the script on you. Glory to God. Because he said, you